Have you washed your filthy hands?
Twice. With your soap.
Put a crew together. We're going after him.
It will give us control of it. If we want to rule more than one small f***ing town, we have to have it. People will come from all over. They do exactly what I tell them if the words are from the book.
It's happened before. And it'll happen again. All we need is that book.
A friend sent me that clip from the 2010 film The Book of Eli. If you're not familiar, the film takes place in a post-apocalyptic world. The main character carries a Bible with him that the villains in the story are desperate to get their hands on. The film does a good job of showing just how important scripture is to the elite. They use it as the foundation of the religious control systems that they orchestrate world events with. These people believe they're superior to us, but in reality, they're the most deceived of all. The god they worship is Lucifer, although he goes by many names, and he has lied to them and convinced them that he will dethrone and replace God. In fact, a common testimony of many witches and Satanists who come to Christ is that Satan always lied to them about the authority of Jesus and his complete victory over Satan and his demons. Literally, all the control systems find their base in the ancient mystery school teachings represented in Kabbalah. In fact, there are ultimately only two religions in the world, the mystery schools and biblical Christianity.
Same rate as all the other stores, my friend.
It comes to 10 shekels and a half.
Take two instead of one. The Lord will be grateful.
Two fine lambs. Two fine lambs.
I did this trick to be defied.
Money and preach somewhere else.
Jerusalem! The faithful city! She that was full of justice has become a harlot!
Stop him!
Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning?
What are your multitude of sacrifices to me, says the Lord? Bring forth no more vain offerings!
You have turned it into a den of thieves!
Man,
he's not the prophet.
God's word and his plan for the redemption of mankind was given to the Israelites. But the rabbis added their law and mystical Babylonian teachings to the scriptures, turning the oracles of God into yet another great religious system. As a result, they misinterpreted the scripture and failed to recognize their long-awaited Messiah, instead rejecting and crucifying him.
Today, in your hearing, the scriptures are fulfilled.
Scriptures are fulfilled. Did he say fulfilled?
But
how can he dare to say such a thing?
What do you mean? The prophecy you have read can only be fulfilled by the coming of the Messiah.
Yes, right.
By the coming of the kingdom of God.
The kingdom of God comes not in a way foreseen by men. Repent and believe the good news. The kingdom of heaven. Behold, is suddenly upon you.
What?
When Christ rose from the grave, he demolished the great control systems and provided the only way to God through repentance, turning from human efforts, disciplines, and religious practice to simple belief in the Son of God, who alone did what no man could ever do. The Pharisees immediately set out to add law, religion, to his message of simple faith. The Apostle Paul fought against the leaven of the scribes and the Pharisees to his dying breath, and God gave the Israelites 40 more years to turn from their wickedness before he poured out his wrath on Jerusalem, utterly destroying it, just as Jesus had prophesied he would. This torrential event has been downplayed in history. We don't hear much about it or its great significance, and there's a reason for that. The gifted attorney and author Philip Mauro wrote, quote, "It is greatly to be regretted that those who in our day give themselves to the study and exposition of prophecy seem not to be aware of the immense significance of the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70, which was accompanied by the extinction of Jewish national existence and the dispersion of the Jewish people among all the nations. The failure to recognize the significance of that event and the vast amount of prophecy which it fulfilled has been the cause of great confusion, for the necessary consequence of missing the past fulfillment of predicted events is to leave on our hands a mass of prophecies for which we must needs contrive fulfillments in the future. The harmful results are twofold. For first, we are thus deprived of the evidential value and the support to the faith of those remarkable fulfillments of prophecy which are so clearly presented to us in authentic contemporary histories, and second, our vision of things to come is greatly obscured and confused by the transference to the future of predicted events which in fact have already happened, and whereof complete records have been preserved for our information," unquote.
Is that thing loaded? I don't think it's loaded.
One way to find out.
Look, I need that book. I mean, I want the book. And you, but if you make me choose, I'll kill you. I'll take the book.
Why? Why do you want it?
I grew up with it. I know its power. But if you read it,
within 300 years, Satan turned the truth of the gospel not only into another religious control system, but into the ultimate heresy that masqueraded as the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, with a mere man standing between men and God who claimed he had the power to forgive their sin. We'll be right back. The Roman Catholic Church took the scriptures from the people to only be interpreted by their learned priests. That's always been a chief method of the control systems. Trust the experts. Through a great move of God, the scriptures were put back into the hands of the common man in the Reformation, but the enemy immediately went to work twisting the meaning of God's word. The Red Horse is ever following and warring against the gospel through Jesuit, Freemasonic, Rosicrucian involvement throughout both church and secular history. It's mistakenly believed by most Christians that occultists reject the Bible, but in reality, Kabbalists and Freemasons embrace God's word, searching for a deeper esoteric meaning in it. In this way, the mystery school teachings have found their way into Christian doctrine. The Book of Revelation is of particular importance to the elite. French occult author and ceremonial magician Eliphas Levi wrote in his book Sanctum Regnum, quote, "But Christ had, as all great teachers have had, one teaching for the people and also an esoteric doctrine. To John, the beloved disciple, he confided the deepest mysteries of the Holy Kabbalah. And John in after years revealed or reveiled them in his Apocalypse, which is indeed a synthesis of all earlier magical, prophetic, and Kabbalistic works." Unquote. The Book of Revelation is of particular importance to the elite. Citing Levi, renowned Freemason Manly P. Hall listed it among the greatest books of Kabbalah. Quote, "According to Eliphas Levi, the three greatest books of Kabbalism are the Sefer Yetzirah, the Book of Formation, the Sefer HaZohar, the Book of Splendor, and the Apocalypse, the Book of Revelation." Unquote. Capitalizing on the difficult symbolism in the Book of Revelation, Satan has used rabbis and occultists to craftily turn it into a deceptive teaching that convolutes the gospel and garners worship for himself. Instead of the hope that the revelation of Jesus Christ is intended to offer, these self-appointed architects of the universe have woven a coming earthly millennial reign of Christ into it that brings a carnal focus, turning world events into a checklist on a physical timeline. And amazingly, Christians are accepting it, where Jesus could not have been more clear.
"If my kingdom were of this world, my followers would have fought to prevent me from being captured."
"Oh, you speak of a kingdom. Therefore, you must be a king. Are you a king?"
"I am."
Futurism brings the hope of a physical kingdom with days of peace and prosperity on earth. Mauro again, quote, "The subject of the 1,000 years is mentioned in Revelation 20, verses 1 through 9, and nowhere else in the Bible. According to John Lightfoot, the term the 1,000 years was commonly applied by the Jewish teachers to the reign of Messiah, which they were confidently expecting and which by their teaching was to be a period of unequaled earthly prosperity and peace, especially for the natural Israel, who, restored nationally and reinstated in the land of Canaan, was to have the place of supreme dominion over all the nations of the world. This rabbinical teaching is the source and the only source of the now popular doctrine of the millennium. For the only passage in the Bible where mention is made of the 1,000 years says not a word about a happy state of things on earth during that period. Indeed, it does not refer to conditions on earth at all. Therefore, It is taking an unwarrantable liberty with the scripture to read the above-mentioned carnal notions into it. Furthermore, nowhere in the New Testament are the saints bidden to look forward to a blissful millennium, intervening between the era of grace and that of glory. The apostles looked, on the contrary, for the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens and the earth, being on fire, shall be dissolved, and according to his promise, for new heavens and a new earth. They seem never to have heard any promise of an intermediate millennial period. The Apostle Paul likewise taught the appearing of the glory of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ as the next thing after this day of grace. And so he teaches elsewhere. The outlook of the saints of Old Testament days was the same. In the view of John Lightfoot and of some others of the older commentators, the 1,000 years is not a period of Earth's history at all, nor a measure of sidereal time, but purely a descriptive term, and moreover, it belongs in the spiritual realm and runs parallel with this current age. They viewed it as a period during which the power of Satan should be so restrained that Christ's servants could go freely about their work of preaching the gospel, and thus despoiling the strong man of his goods, he being bound. When they could testify the grace of God without fear of violence, imprisonment, persecution, torture, and death, which would have been their portion in previous times. If this view be the right one, then there is yet to be a little season during which Satan will be loosed, and when he will gather hosts of spiritual wickedness in heavenly places against the saints of God, and in that final assault he will employ methods and devices of an entirely new sort. But Christ will appear opportunely for the deliverance of his people, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God. The last enemy will be destroyed. The heavens and earth will be purified by fire. The judgment of the great white throne will immediately ensue, and eternity will begin for the saints of God. This view merits a careful examination, for certainly it is much more consonant with the whole doctrine of Scripture than is the crude and casual Jewish conception of an earthly millennium. Unquote. The earthly reign of Messiah from Jerusalem was what the rabbis were looking for when Christ came, and when Jesus didn't fit their faulty interpretation of Scripture, they rejected him and had him crucified. Tragically, the people went along. They wanted Barabbas, and they still want Barabbas today.
Barabbas!
Barabbas! Release Jesus! He is the true prophet!
Rabbis, Kabbalists, Freemasons, basically all religions look forward to a coming golden age when a Christ, either in concept or an actual entity, will reign on earth. Traditional theosophy sees Christ as a symbolic term for the divine principle of spirit. Theosophist Helena Blavatsky wrote that, quote, Christ is not a being or an entity of any kind. Christ is not another name for Maitreya. Christ is not the master of masters. Christ is not the so-called world teacher. And there is no such thing as the second coming or reappearance of Christ. Christ never had a first coming, and has never appeared, nor can ever appear. Why? Because Christ, from the Greek Christos, is simply a symbolic term and name for the purely impersonal and universal divine principle of spirit, which is present in everything in the universe. Unquote. Blavatsky, of course, is known as the mother of the New Age movement, which today is telling us that we are the Christs of the New Age. Here's a quote from the website Golden Age of Gaia. You are the Christs of this new era. You will bring peace in a world of duality and polarity by radiating the peace that lies within your own hearts. Unquote. Theosophists Annie Besant, Alice Bailey, and others also taught of a coming Christ, Maitreya, who will reign in a coming golden era of peace and prosperity.
The Christ is really not the name of an individual. It's the name of a great master, a great, powerfully, highly evolved man. In fact, the master of all the masters. And the masters are men like us who have really preceded us in evolution and finished this evolutionary path on which we are all set. So the Lord Maitreya, to give him his personal name, who is the master who embodies what we call the Christ principle.
Lord Maitreya is not a name which most Christians would associate with the Christ. What is his relationship to the Christ?
Maitreya and the Christ are one and the same individual. And he worked through Jesus by overshadowing Jesus 2,000 years ago in Palestine. His consciousness entered into that of Jesus at the baptism. And from the baptism to the crucifixion, Jesus was the Christ. This time, the Christ himself, the Lord Maitreya himself, has come into the world.
Benjamin, why has he returned now? Is there any particular relationship to the year 2000 or what's known as the millennium?
Yes, it's a cosmic date that determines his coming. See, our sun is traveling around the heavens in relation to the constellations. There are 12 constellations which make up what we call the zodiac. And approximately every 2,150 years, our sun comes into an alignment with each of these constellations in turn. The energies given to us, radiated to us by the particular constellation with which our sun is in alignment, create the conditions of our various civilizations. They give it a particular quality. We were in the age of Pisces. This is now coming to an end. It was inaugurated by Jesus as the Christ 2,000 years ago. Maitreya has returned to take up the work which will be really the work of the cycle of Aquarius. This is the dawning of the
age of Aquarius. Speaking of a coming millennial age, Shabbat.org states, quote, "Some people believe that the world will evolve by itself into a messianic era without a human figurehead. Judaism rejects this belief." Unquote.
This Mashiach will be a time where there will be a physical and spiritual completion of the world. What does this mean? There will be this harmony of physical and spiritual. The physical world will no longer allow the possibility for suffering. And at the same time, there will be a revelation of God. The Mashiach will come. What does this mean? Mashiach will be a prophet like Moses. He will be the highest Jew, so to speak. He will be at the holiest level, the loftiest level. The Mashiach will be the one closest to Hashem, and he will teach the people, the nation, the world at large, how to connect to God in a better way.
Islam awaits the coming of their Messiah as the Imam Mahdi, a descendant of the Prophet Muhammad, a chosen one who will bring a time of justice and peace to the world. Vedic prophecy speaks of a golden age of Kali, a time of spiritual consciousness, unity, and harmony. Regardless of their definition of Christ, they all anticipate a coming age of peace and prosperity, making it evident that the source of this teaching is the mystery schools, and not Jesus Christ or the apostles. I remember how the teaching of a temporary 1,000-year earthly millennial reign used to confuse me. And that's one of the many purposes of dispensationalism, to create such a convoluted, confusing narrative that the average believer gives up and leaves it to the experts to interpret, which is nothing short of a return to the papal authority that kept the people in darkness for centuries. These are the aspirations of Satan, whose goal is to dethrone God and reign as God over the earth in a restored Atlantean kingdom. This world is all he has, which is why the trademark of all these false narratives are their carnal nature and the deification of carnal man. Their spiritual-sounding promised hope is empty. There's only one true Christ, who proved that he was God by rising from the grave 3 days after he was crucified.
Where's the book?
Give him the book, please.
Don't tell him.
In-house. Back of the TV.
Don't check the TV.
Futurism obscures the miracle of Christ's kingdom reign in our current age. It has effectively transformed the unveiling of Jesus Christ into the unveiling of Lucifer. Grandmaster Freemason Albert Pike notably spoke of the unveiling of Lucifer at a future time when he will accomplish complete dominion over the earth. He famously wrote in his Three World Wars letter to Giuseppe Mazzini, the Italian revolutionary, quote, "Then everywhere the citizens, obliged to defend themselves against the world minority of revolutionaries, will exterminate those destroyers of civilization, and the multitude disillusioned with Christianity, whose deistic spirits will from that moment be without compass or direction, anxious for an ideal, but without knowing where to render its adoration, will receive the true light through the universal manifestation of the pure doctrine of Lucifer, brought finally out into view." Unquote. UN Representative David Spangler echoes this aspiration. Quote, "Lucifer comes to give us the final Luciferic initiation that many people now and in the days ahead will be facing, for it is an initiation into the new age. No one will enter the new world order unless he or she will make a pledge to worship Lucifer. No one will enter the new age unless he will take a Luciferian initiation." Unquote. In her book, The Secret Doctrine 2, Helena Blavatsky wrote, quote, "Satan is the god of our planet and the only god." She also wrote on page 513, quote, "Lucifer is divine and terrestrial light, the Holy Ghost and Satan at one and the same time. And now it stands proven that Satan, or the red fiery dragon, and Lucifer, or light bearer, is in us. It is our mind, our tempter and redeemer, our intelligent liberator and savior." Unquote. Mauro interpreted the black horse of Revelation as commercialism, and the world banking elite, positioning themselves to dominate the world in a one-world government. He believed that he was living in the final days before Christ's return 100 years ago. I'm amazed at his insights, and can't help but wonder what he would have to say if he were alive today. He explained that the pale horse represents the death of the gospel, finally being removed from the earth through deception and heresy. It stands as the opposite to the conquering white horse, hence completing the picture. Apostle Paul likened Satan to a roaring lion. A roaring lion is hard to ignore, but as deceptions and cataclysmic events increase, we need to keep in mind that Satan has always sought to kill, steal, and destroy. These things are now only intensifying, being brought into the open, and being veiled in countless conflicting narratives. By contrast, God speaks with a still small voice. All in God's hand, all in good time.
All in God's hand. The focus on temporal events that's been woven into prophetic teaching has served to obscure the fact that Satan's power is nothing in comparison to the power of Christ, who will destroy him in the brightness of his coming. How do they plan to play it all out? The narratives that have been spun from the Bible and other religious writings are so complex, intertwined, and convoluted that it's tempting to throw up our hands and say, together with Pontius Pilate, "What is truth?" It's all designed to keep us chasing our tails in pursuit of knowledge, and none of it has anything to do with what the revelation given to John was actually about, which is the immeasurable hope we have in Christ. Instead, Christians are effectively being turned into Kabbalists, ushering in a counterfeit messianic age, a new Atlantis, what Jesus referred to as the days of Noah. We all carry hopes and dreams, wanna keep the flame alive. Like the fire of eternal life that he places deep inside. Yeah. An everlasting love that will Satan's religions always boil down to man overcoming his fallen state through his own effort. Their focus is always on this life, in this world, his world. Unimaginable efforts have been made to convolute and obscure the simplicity of the gospel. It's because it's the most powerful truth in the world. God became man to set men free and give them spiritual life. Paul's prayer for the Ephesians was not that God would come down and reign in this temporal world, or for them to go through efforts to pave the way for his return. He prayed that they would be able to comprehend the immeasurable nature of God's love toward them, and the enormity of their salvation and identity in him.
For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. That day when freed from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransomed soul away. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless day. Oh, to grace how great a debtor, daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it, seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.